Hey everyone, I'm Sahil Mittal here for the NBA G League Tracker, and I'd like to welcome you back to a new episode of G League Conversations. Today's guest is Windy City Bulls guard Thomas Wilder. Thanks for taking some time to come on the show.
No, thanks for having me, bro.
So let's go back to the beginning of your professional career. When you came out of college and you were, and when you declared for the draft, what was your draft workout process like?
So I had like 10 workouts, I think. My first one was with, who was my first workout with? I can't remember, but I had like 10 workouts. And then, I went undrafted basically, like, that was really, really it.
So after the draft, you said you ended up going undrafted. Was the G League your first idea to, like, pursue after the draft?
No. So even going further than that, like, I didn't know nothing. I didn't really know, like, how the process worked or nothing. So I was on the mock drafts. So my first intention is, like, I want to go to the league, you know. And so then when I went undrafted, boom. Now it's like, all right, now what I got to do. And then I knew I was like, I didn't want to go to the G League just like without a deal, you know what I'm saying? Without either a training camp deal or two-way or whatever. So then overseas team contacted me, got in touch with me, and then I went over there for like 2 months. And then after I got kind of homesick, and I was just like, man, I'm trying to come back. So then when I came back, then it was just like, all right, now I'm going to go to the G League.
Where did you play overseas?
Ludwigsburg in Ludwigsburg, Germany.
So what was the biggest difference then between playing overseas and playing in the G League?
Overseas is kind of more like college, you know. There's no defensive 3 seconds. Teams can kind of pack it in on you. And it's more team oriented, I would say. Like in the G League, you know, they want quick scores and there's a lot of threes and stuff like that. So I would say the game is different in that sense, probably.
So then when you came back to the G League, you ended up going to the Windy City Bulls. In your rookie season, you had like a lot of different veterans on the team. Jakar Sampson, right, you guys picked up, Walt Lemon. Yeah. What were you able to learn from some of the guys on that team?
I learned a lot from all those vets, even like CJ, yeah. CJ Fair, Pharaoh. So I learned a lot from those guys, but the main thing probably would be like is how to be a pro. You know, coming out of college, it's a little different. You know, you kind of are given a schedule, like practices at this time, you got class from this time, you got study hall from this time to this time. So your days are kind of mapped out for you. But when you're a professional, it's just one obligation, and that's practice at, if practice is at 11, now you got practice from 11 to 1 or 12:30. And now you got the rest of your day, and it's like, what are you doing with the rest of your day? You could either be going back to the gym, getting more shots up, watching film, stretching, taking care of your body, or you could just be, you know what I'm saying, just do it. You could get lost. It's easy to get, like, lost and kind of, like, stagnant, I feel like, because you're just not used to creating your own schedule. So I would say I probably learned that the most from those guys is how to be a professional.
You talked about, like, you had, like, a lot of free time, like, after practice and stuff. What else did you really try to focus on during your rookie season when you had that extra time?
My rookie year, I think I was just going back to the gym. I didn't have it all the way together my rookie year. Like, I was still trying to figure things out. But I think for the most part, I was probably going to the gym. Yeah.
So then, over your 2 seasons in Windy City, I've watched a lot of the games. I've noticed you're like a really good defender. Has defense always been something that's important, and why is it so important?
Defense is important just because. So when I was growing up, when I was growing up on my first AAU team, we were really good, but I didn't have the role of being the scorer, being the somebody to create plays on the offensive end. I was kind of just put in there for defensive purposes, guard the best player, and then if I got, you know, some points along the way, then I was just a plus. But like, so my defensive, like the defense come from like even that far back, and just my dad always kind of tells me like, yeah, the best defender, if you're the best defender, you go play. If you're the best shooter, you go play. So like, it was always easier for me to be the best defender on the team because I was just like something I knew I could control. So it started then. And then as I got older, I started to develop an offensive game. And then, but the defense was still always there. And then now in college, I was still a really good defender. But I took on more of the scoring load. So, then when I went professionally, I was struggling on the offensive end, but like, I feel like that's the reason I was able to still find minutes because defensively, I was still making impact on the game defensively if all those fails. So, it's huge because I feel like I look at it as a way to kind of separate yourself. And then if you're struggling on the offensive end, that's something that like you can control. You can control your energy on the defensive end and like being locked in on that side of the ball. So, I think that's huge.
So in your rookie season, do you have like a favorite memory from playing with Windy City that year?
I don't really even know if it was just like one specific moment, but it was just like, I had a lot of fun that year. I made some like lifelong friends, I feel like, on the team. A lot of those guys I still talk to. So like, I don't know if it was just like one specific moment. I mean, making the playoffs for the first time was pretty cool, but I don't know if it was just like one specific moment that stood out.
So moving into your second year with Windy City, what were your goals going into the season? What were you trying to improve? What were you trying to do better at?
Going into my second season, I was trying to improve my jump shot, really. But honestly, bro, like mentally, I was like kind of out of it that year just because like I didn't know what I was trying to do. I didn't know if I was like still trying to hoop or not. And you know what I'm saying? So, like, my working out schedule kind of was, like, all messed up, you know? Like, I really wasn't in the gym consistently like that. So, like, I was intending on improving my jump shot, but, like, I didn't put the work in that I should have, you know what I'm saying? So, like, but that was the intent going into the year was improve my work on my jump shot. And, that was pretty much it. And, but the same has been for this year, though, like, I feel like really that's the only thing that's kind of, cause like in college I was a really good shooter, and then I've been struggling since I've been a pro, kind of shooting the outside shot, getting adjusted to the NBA three. So that's still kind of my main focus is just like becoming a better shooter and more consistent shooter.
So this past year you also had the chance to play with Bol Bol. There's a lot of hype around that. He came down. Fans were always packed when he was there. What did you see in him that you think is going to make him a really good player in the future?
I think how versatile he is, bro. Like, he really is like a 7-foot guard, really. Yeah. Like, because even if you go back to like his high school highlights, he was like making plays on the perimeter, you know. And I feel like that's where he's comfortable at, and I think that's like real unique. And then like his shot blocking ability, like he could be a presence in that end. Obviously he has to, you know, gain some more weight and stuff, but that's like gonna come with time. He's still young, but I think he's gonna be really good because he's just so versatile. Hit perimeter shots, can put the ball on the floor, can, you know, make plays in the open court too if he has to. And I think he showed that a couple of times in like in the bubble. He made a few plays, like dribbled the ball up court and then like shot a pull up three. So like, yeah, he's capable of that. He's capable of being a really good player, I think.
So when the season got canceled this year, How did you guys all find out? How did that whole process go down? Because you guys were scheduled to play, I think, either the next day or the day after.
Yeah, it was a while ago, so I can't remember like exactly what happened, but as far as I remember, it was like, so we were getting told about the coronavirus like weeks and weeks prior before like the season actually got canceled. So it first started off with like, yeah, it's not that big of a deal, like we're gonna be fine. And then like maybe a week or two later, it was like, all right, they're saying, you know, it's getting worse, but like still y'all wash your hands and stuff, we'll be good. And then like the next time they told us about it, it was like, yeah, the season might be canceled. So it was just like, it just kind of happened fast, bro. Like it just happened out of nowhere, kind of like, yeah, it kind of shocked all of us, really.
Yeah, I remember I was there. The last game you guys played, I think, at home, they had like the barricades up between the stands and the court. And then they had like signs all over the place. Like you guys weren't allowed to sign autographs. You weren't allowed to.
Right. Yeah. I forgot about that. They stopped letting us sign autographs. Yeah, I forgot about that.
Yeah. So
that's crazy.
Yeah. Have you heard anything about this upcoming G League season at all, about whether or not it's going to happen at all, if it's going to start late? Like, what do you think? Have you heard anything?
Well, I heard that they may have a season, but I think it's still so much uncertainty, like people don't know really. But I heard that they still may have a season, though. I hope they do. I mean, yeah, I hope they do, especially for the guys that, you know, the high school kids and stuff that decided to go that route. So I hope we could do something.
So if the G League doesn't happen, if it doesn't happen this year, if it doesn't work out, do you think you might give overseas a shot again?
I think I'll think about it more when, like, if that time presents itself. Right now, I'm just kind of focusing on like being in the moment. But like, yeah, if it gets to that point where I have to, where that's like a, where that may be something that has to happen, then I would be open to like thinking about it more and stuff like that. It's not like I have anything, but it's just like I have a son now, so right. I had a son, so it's a little more difficult to make just like that decision. Like if you'd asked me before he was born, like would I go overseas if the G League didn't have a season, that's a like automatic yes, you know. But like now I'm thinking for also him and, you know, my family and stuff. So yeah, I don't know. I would be open to thinking about going over there for sure, or thinking about figuring out how to, yeah, whatever makes the most sense.
Yeah, that's definitely going to be interesting seeing what happens. Maybe I've heard a little bit that they're thinking about doing like regional bubbles for the G League possibly.
Right.
So many things. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Yeah. Hopefully we can get an answer here soon. So if they do have a season, it's definitely going to be after the year, but I would say maybe like February or March, I would think. That's what I kind of comment, you know.
If you had to give yourself some advice, your rookie self some advice, what would you give? What advice would you give yourself?
I think probably staying in the moment, and like staying the course, looking at things is like a process, you know, like not wanting to see results like so soon, you know. Just kind of sticking, staying down, staying the course, and staying the moment. Yeah.
I wanted to ask you about something now that I've seen kind of all of your Instagram. You started selling some shirts with these words on it, "under construction." What does that mean to you, and why is that so important to you?
Right. Well, so under construction, how under construction came, it was just like, that's how that was a point where I felt I was at in my life. Like I had surgery. I needed to get surgery on my groin. So I had a sports hernia that I had to get fixed. So I was like recovering from that. And then like, you know, the whole coronavirus stuff was like, just like going crazy. And then I was just like, man, like, I feel like I'm under construction. Cause I was also like, I knew the gyms were going to be closed and stuff like that. So I was like, I got to find something to, you know, to kind of be productive. So I started like trying to figure out, learn new skills and stuff like that. And I was just like, man, I feel like I'm under construction right now. Like, so that's how that kind of how it came about. So then when I would just start working out, and then I was like, dang, that's like, you could apply that to like every facet of your life. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, you're always under construction, or you always like should be under construction if you're trying to better yourself. So then I started, when I would be working out, I just put like under construction, or when I'll be doing something that was like productive or like investing in myself and my better well-being, then it'll be like, I'll just put under construction. So it started to like gain a little bit of steam and stuff like that. And then I started to make little videos and stuff. And then I made a video and I had on an under construction shirt, and everybody, and then people just started hitting me up like, bro, I need one. So then I just like, I knew I was, cause like I said, I was looking at different, you know, avenues and different things, like, ways to make money, or, you know, just kind of like stepping outside of my comfort zone and stepping outside of like the basketball box, like, you know, that they want to put you in, like, you're a basketball player and that's it. So like, I'm just trying to figure out ways to step outside of that. So I knew I wanted to like start branding myself outside of that, but I didn't necessarily like know how. But then when everybody starts saying like, yeah, bro, I want a shirt, I'm like, all right, I'm like, just everybody put your size. And then I just start getting a whole bunch of people that put their size and said they wanted a shirt. So then I just ended up selling the shirts, and it was cool. Like, people got the shirts, and people was like messing with the movement and stuff. But I went through I tried to get a LLC for under construction, and it was already taken, like the clothing brand. So it was already taken. So that's kind of like what I've been doing. I've been trying to figure out, like, do I want to come out with a, cause along that process, I learned that I enjoy like the creative part of making clothes and stuff like that. And I like to wear nice clothes. So like, that might be something I pursue a little bit down the road, maybe a couple years down the road, a year or two down the road. But it was fun. It was fun. So like, that's something I'm going to keep in my back pocket and probably going to get into at some point in the future.
Yeah, I know a lot of basketball players in general are transitioning and like doing other things outside of the basketball. I mean, your former teammate, John Octias, he's started a meal prep company down in Florida. Yeah. I just think it's interesting how all these athletes are expanding just outside of their respective sports.
No, it is big, because like I said, they try to put you in a box a lot of times. Like, even like when you look at, I don't even remember the lady's name, but when she told LeBron, like, shut up and dribble, like, that's all they, when you're a basketball player, they think like you can't have no other opinion, or you can't be, you can't do anything else other than play basketball. Or the same goes for any other sport or any other profession. But when you really look at it and say like, all right, especially for an athlete, we have a lot of time on our hands. You know what I'm saying? Like, if you think about how long we're in the gym, you work out for 2 hours, you go work, you lift for another hour, that's 3 hours. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's 3 hours out of the day. So what are you doing with the rest of your time? And it's like, there's more than enough time to do other stuff. It's just about finding like what it is that you enjoy, and how can you monetize that and make it a profitable business, you know? Yeah, so I think it's cool, like, seeing all these guys like go out and do different things and kind of like spread their wings, get out of that box.
Yeah, it's definitely interesting. I just want to say thank you for coming on the show. Really appreciate it, and good luck with whatever happens next year, whether it's the G League or whatever else you pursue.
No, for sure, bro. Thank you for having me.